Section 22 of The Shining Pyramid, The Definitive Edition, by Arthur Machen. It's LibriVox recordings in the public domain. Read by Ben Tucker. New Lamps for Old. As a belated reader of Mr. Wells' New Worlds for Old, and a confirmed anti-socialist, I should like to say quite unofficially how much I appreciate the moderation and the genial reasonableness with which the author puts the case for a partial reconstruction of the social order. I say partial advisedly, since Mr. Wells is careful not to promise any new heavens or new earth, and while he argues that the great majority of people would be much more comfortable and more free from worry under the new system, he is also honest and sensible enough to admit that, with many of us, it would be practically as you were. Authors who did not please large numbers of people would be no better off than now, and as for that vision of municipalities contending for the honor of publishing our books, well, I for one cannot realize it, cannot believe in it at all, unless it is presumed that the mere readjustment of economic conditions would so change the hearts of aldermen that London would become an ancient Athens, or as medieval Florence. Still, New Worlds for Old is an interesting, an amiable, and a suggestive book. One knows how the socialist position is presented by certain other writers in the same cause. I am perfectly sober at the moment of writing, I beg to say, and one is thankful for Mr. Wells' good nature and moderation. But there is a root idea behind his arguments which we would like to have more fully elucidated. That is his doctrine of the universal goodwill, and of its issue in a constant upward progress. Is it really proven that the universal goodwill is any more real than the universal evil will? Is blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord a fact, while crucify him is an illusion? I know Mr. Wells's point of view is the popular one. It is the thing to dance a kind of world dance to the accompaniment of a cosmic "For We Are Jolly Good Fellows." Dr. Horton danced this dance in a recent book. To him the universe seemed to consist of summer seas, cooing doves, skipping lambs, and Hampstead Congregationalists. He forgot the storms and the water floods and the cobras and the devilfish and the Roman Catholics. Surely a good many of us are jolly bad fellows, and unfortunately we often get the upper hand and give the good fellows the very devil's own time. I am not aware that any deep thinker of the past has ever maintained this doctrine of the universal goodwill of men, and even if there has been such a thinker, I would respectfully submit that the proposition is against the weight of evidence. Rabelais occurs to me. He certainly made "Do as you please" the motto of the great Abbey of Thelema, on the ground that well-born and well-bred people of liberal education will always do the right thing. But then, unfortunately, that is not true. And if it were true, there are so many of us who are neither well-born, well-bred, nor well-educated. I think we might go so far with Mr. Wells as to say that it is somewhat easier to be a great saint than a great sinner. By "a great sinner" is not meant l'homme moyen sensuel, but I do not see how this is to help us, since true sanctity and true sin are fine arts only for a few men in any age. Frankly, I fail to see that the predominance of goodwill has been established. On the contrary, I should be inclined to say that on the whole, in temporal matters only, the evil will has had the upper hand. Eternity is beyond Mr. Wells' purview, so here I say nothing of that. But in Syria, and in Middlesex, and in the United States of America, the prophets are mostly stoned. And then there is the corollary to the universal goodwill proposition, the universal progress upwards. Now, are there any solid reasons for believing in anything of the kind? I am sure that Mr. Wells does not limit the sense of the word progress to mere bodily ease and security. It would be an injustice to attribute such a folly as that to any unconvinced human being. I should even doubt whether Mr. R.J. Campbell of the City Temple really believes this ichthyosaurus of a fallacy, though he seems to now and then. Mr. Wells would certainly not commit himself to such a definition, since, both as artist and thinker, he has every reason to know better. To know that man is an extraordinary complex, who is sometimes quite unaffected by physical conditions. St. Thomas Aquinas was absolutely unaffected by the splendors and delicacies of the king's banquet. St. Polycarp was happy in the flames. Cervantes, old and hungry and neglected, was certainly happy in his Don Quixote. And I am sure that the man who carved the Lincoln imp was happy, in spite of bad water, bad food, and the entire absence of sanitation. These people may have been very silly, but that has nothing to do with it. They were men, and they count, as I am sure Mr. Wells would be the first to allow. Indeed, his book makes it plain that he does not sum up everything desirable under the headings of shelter and dinner. This being allowed, is it certain that progress is so constant as he would have us believe? The other day I saw a bit of very simple jewelry made by some black fellow in Central Africa. The materials were gold, and a few hairs from an elephant's tail. The result was a quaint and delightful bracelet, made delicately, fancifully, with originality. I compared it in my mind with 9/10 of the work in the average jeweler's shop in London. The horrible barbarism of the latter was too painfully manifest. Then it seems to me, qua his craft, the London jeweler has not progressed beyond the black savage. On the contrary, he is hundreds of years behind the Negro. He is thousands of years behind the old Celt, the Roman, the Egyptian, the Trojan. And as for other things, what evidence is there to show that tram cars and slate roofs and adulterated food and Russian spirit weigh down the balance on the side of progress? In other words, why should we be certain that the working jeweler of London or Birmingham is a happier man than his black brother? There may, of course, be a certain joy in fastening an enormous diamond into a ring of cast-iron pattern. I am sure it is not to be compared with the joy of making a queer but delightful jewel out of one's own head, a little gold, and some elephant hairs. And the Negro race is proverbially backward. It has never made any figure in the arts, and we are the most progressive of nations. But can we altogether congratulate ourselves on our progress? So far as I understand Mr. Wells, he is content, after all, to rest his case on material advantages, especially on those which proceed from humanitarian emotion. He confesses that the intrusion of the sign of some quack medicine into a pleasant landscape is an outrage. But he adds very truly that it is a better sight than that of a wretched malefactor hanging in chains. I quite admit this. But is Mr. Wells sure that this decided improvement in externals proceeds from a true improvement in the human heart? It must be remembered that there are many cruel and wicked people who faint at the sight of blood. There are many gluttons and good diners who would not like to see the pig's throat cut or the ox felled to the ground. I do not think that I am the more humane, being an eater of lobsters, because I should not like to plunge the wretched creature into boiling water. Is it quite certain that this outward improvement that we are talking about is not very largely due to a mere nervous sensibility, to a dislike of horrid sights and sounds? I suppose there are many people who hear with relief, with satisfaction even, that some cruel and malignant ruffian has been hanged, and yet these people would fall fainting with horror if they were made to witness that last awful scene. And then again we congratulate ourselves that our state is infinitely better than that of the Borgias. But is it really better? Were the Borgias, the poisoners of the exalted, so much worse than the persons who come to honor and great fortune by selling poisonous provisions to the helpless poor? We do not burn people alive now, save in the highly civilized United States of America. We do not sack cities. But how many people in the last 10 years have been brought to ruin, misery, starvation, anguish, and suicide by financial operations? To see with eyes of the flesh a human being burned alive must be an unspeakably awful sight. But perhaps it would not be less awful in reality if we could see with the eyes of the spirit the sum of human agony caused in 1 year by the holy office of the prospectus. And as to what may be called our modern sanitary advantages, I quite agree that if other things were equal, they would be real advantages. If life were happy, it would be better to have a reasonable prospect of living to 80 instead of a reasonable prospect of dying of the Black Death at 30. But if the other things are not equal, if modern life, as seen by its expression in art, is not so happy as ancient or medieval life, if it is on the whole and demonstrably an ugly, that is, an unhappy life, then where is the immense benefit of prolonging it? One can certainly have too much of a bad thing. The maxim as to Cathay in Europe is perhaps of doubtful truth in the instances selected. But no one doubts the soundness of the general principle. Most men would prefer one exquisite dish before 10 courses of insipidity or nastiness. I have never heard a really sober art critic express a wish that Mr. Collier's pictures were ever so much larger, and literary men do not long for a sequel to The Sorrows of Satan. Indeed, it seems to me that all the contrivances to prolong life and to make it more comfortable, from good drains to improved surgery and anesthetics, have been more than counterbalanced by a certain influence that I do not remember to have seen noted in this connection. The fact is that the modern world is profoundly cowardly, with the anxious, incessant, ever-gnawing cowardice that allows the patient no rest. To be quite familiar, we are in a blue funk. We know the names of diseases. We know their symptoms. We know all about our own insides. We are in a perpetual terror lest something should be mortally wrong with us. It is possible that the bodily terrors of the average modern man who attains the average length of days, if added together, would surpass all the torments and the terrors of the poor wretch who swung from the cart at Tyburn. To take the case of malignant disease, today the sufferer from carcinoma experiences, in spirit, in dread, in foreknowledge, 10 times the inevitable anguish of the body. Of old, such a person would die after great physical pain assuredly, but not after months or years of unspeakable mental agony. And of old, the torments of the body might and often did become transmuted into the joys of the spirit. Now, progress has in many cases made this impossible. In this progress, the poet in Bel Ami saw nothing but ever-increasing woe and misery, with that awful grand cul but death as a close. He argued acutely and philosophically that as the sense of things became keener, the intellect more refined, so much deeper and more profound would become the wretchedness of man, so much more horrible the dread of the black pit of extinction. In all honesty and frankness, I cannot believe for a moment that Mr. Wells has proved his proposition of a constant, steady, and universal progress to better, that is, happier, things. Slavery is theoretically a bad state, for instance, and I am sure that the average slave in Virginia was a much happier man than is the average millionaire in New York today. Theoretically, the former was a wretch, lacking every opportunity of happiness, liable to every extremity of woe. Theoretically, the latter is the overman, the being who can command every advantage and every bliss. In honest fact, it is the millionaire who deserves our profound pity, while the slave was often the merriest of men. In other words, the happiness of man, whether it be of a high or low degree, depends on facts which are nowise related to the physical and material sphere. The new lamp may be of superior shape and elegance to the old. It will never summon the genie. It will never build the magical palace wherein the soul of man can dwell in peace and in delight. End of section 22. New Lamps for Old. Section 23 of The Shining Pyramid, the Definitive Edition, by Arthur Machen. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain, read by Ben Tucker. Mandatum Novissimum. There is a certain puzzling question that I often think over. It is something like this. Suppose a painter coming from his studio, conscious of hopeless failure in the picture that was to have been the sum of all his art, a writer laying down his pen with the cold conviction that his great romance is in reality a 10th-rate novel, a husband standing by the deathbed of his wife. The problem which perplexes me is, would any one of these three be rendered any happier by the offer of a dinner at a first-class restaurant with a box for one of Mr. Shaw's plays to follow? Personally, I don't think even the finest consommé would be balm in either of these three cases. And so I don't believe Mr. Shaw is right when he says that poverty is the great evil of evils, and that if everybody had a pound a day for life, everybody would be happy. I believe, on the contrary, that many men with a pound a day could be produced who are not at all happy. That is a demonstrable fact that there is no connection whatever between money and happiness. I presume, of course, that Mr. Shaw means by money that which money can purchase, comfortable houses, nice dinners, and a month in the Highlands, for the universal consent has pronounced the man who loves money for its own sake as above all men miserable. The fact is, I have been reading the preface to Major Barbara, called by Mr. Shaw, First Aid to Critics. One may pass by the paragraphs which show the critics to have been mistaken in deriving that which Mr. Shaw calls the Shavian Anschauung from Schopenhauer, Nietzsche, Ibsen, Strindberg, Tolstoy, or some other heresiarch in Northern or Eastern Europe. The ingenious author sets us right on this point, and one feels gratified. There are many people who are content to take rather a steep walk from Cheltenham up to the hills where the tiny sources of the Thames are to be seen, and they remain the bubbling wells afterwards when they stand on London Bridge and view the mighty flood roll outward to the sea. But this information as to Mr. Shaw's origins, though deeply interesting in itself, is not altogether to my purpose, which is more concerned with the Anshong itself than with its primal founts. Mr. Shaw, of course, is a dangerous subject to handle. I am told that he is very fond of jokes, and does not always quite mean what he says. Still, one must accept the written word for what it is worth, and bear the inevitable jocularity with the best grace possible. I gather, then, that our ingenious author thinks that the greatest of evils and the worst of crimes is poverty. This is the firm belief of one of the characters in Major Barbara, but Mr. Shaw speaks of Undershaft's conviction of this irresistible natural truth, so with hesitation, I am content to accept this doctrine of poverty as Mr. Shaw's own belief, especially as a few pages farther on Mr. Cobden Sanderson's plan of universal pensions for life is declared to be the solution of the industrial problem. Again, we have the declaration that any punishment of any kind is a malicious injury, and an act of diabolical cruelty. An instance is given. Suppose a burglar broke into Mr. Shaw's house and stole his wife's diamonds. It would be a monstrous retaliation on Mr. Shaw's part if he got the man 10 years penal servitude. On the same principle, we are told that the anarchist attempt to blow the king and queen of Spain to pieces on their wedding day was natural enough, though foolish. While on the other hand, the attempts of the authorities to arrest the assassin with the view of punishing him were a raging fire of malice, and the people who wanted to catch him were human wolves howling for his blood. And here one must speak out. Mr. Shaw, who will be after his jokes, gives, as I've noted, a formidable list of his literary ancestors. These are Charles Lever, a Mr. Ernest Belford Bax, a Captain Wilson — the captain had a very poor opinion of the Sermon on the Mount — a Mr. Stuart Glenny, and the author of Erewhon. All are little rivulets that have gone to feed the great flood called George Bernard Shaw. But Mr. Shaw will be jesting. All that discourse of anarchism to which I have alluded, all the fun about the Spanish anarchist and the bomb, are taken straight out of Robert Louis Stevenson's The Dynamiter. A capital book, though Mr. William Archer does not like it very much. If I may be Shavian for one little moment, if I may for a fleet instant wear the cloak of the prophet, if I may say that I have not yet attempted to give an eager public any insight into the springs and fountains of the Machenian Anshong, it really looks rather well. But to be serious, I may say that I have some title to speak about the Dynamiter, because I conveyed its manner and methods for a book of mine called The Three Impostors. I was not so fortunate as Mr. Shaw. The reviewers told me quite simply that I had cribbed from Stevenson. It must be so much nicer to have an Anshong, and to derive it from a formidable list of heresiarchs. But as a student of the Dynamiter, I must reiterate my conviction that the poor Spaniard, striking his little blow for the good and the true, trying his poor best to make the earth a paradise by inflicting cruel and violent death upon two harmless young people, and then flying, poor hunted creature, from the wolves howling for his blood — all this is pure Dynamiter. The Irish-American in that moving history walks through Leicester Square, full of old men and small children and nursery maids wondering where he can plant his instrument of wholesale death to the best advantage. And while he looks out for a cozy corner, he suddenly reflects on the fact that the savage hounds of tyranny may even now be on his trail, that if his mission were known, he might be torn to pieces by a cruel and ruthless mob. I think he sheds tears. I am sure Mr. Shaw has wept not a little over the fate of the fulminating Spaniard. Indeed, as he says, the Spaniards are fond of bullfighting, which to be sure is a cruel pastime enough. And of course, if people like bullfighting, it is simple reason that their young king and queen should be blown to fragments. And if a few royal servants and spectators and poor folk are blown to bits with them, why, all the better, as such treatment teaches us that we must not be cruel and shut up burglars in nasty prisons. Still, I think GBS might have mentioned RLS. Captain Wilson, who didn't approve of the counsels of perfection, and Mr. Ernest Belford Bax, a ruthless critic of current morality, no doubt sound more serious and respectable. But I wish Mr. Shaw had not forgotten the poor teller of many tales. But we must not wander from our proper field. We have seen that poverty is the greatest of crimes and evils, that £365 per annum for everybody would mean the golden age, that all punishment is wrong, except punishment inflicted on innocent people by courageous souls. Let it be once more repeated to fulminate those who mean only good is natural and proper and excellent, things being as they are. To send a macareux, or a torturer of children, to jail is a horrible and inhuman outrage. It is equivalent to decreeing that everyone found to be suffering from chickenpox shall be immediately inoculated with smallpox. Let us also remember that to teach children that it is sinful to desire money is to strain upwards the extreme possible limit of impudence in lying and corruption and hypocrisy. The universal regard for money is the one hopeful fact in our civilization, the one sound spot in our social conscience. Money is the most important thing in the world. It represents health, strength, honor, generosity, and beauty as conspicuously and undeniably as the want of it represents illness, weakness, disgrace, meanness, and ugliness. Money is the counter that enables life to be distributed socially. It is life as truly as sovereigns and banknotes are money. This is indeed the new evangel. Here is hustle with a halo, with a vengeance. Sancta Rockefeller, ora pro nobis. O blessed be it, intercede for us. O holy Barnato, pray for us. O all ye holy and blessed millionaires who, despising, with the singular Captain Wilson, the vigorous Belford Bax, the beatific butler, with all other adulterating and admirable plutocrats, who, despising the joys of poverty, the delights of conformity, the pleasures of submission, all ye who, trampling on celestial joys, have gloriously elected to trample on the poor, who have amassed enormous sums in sound government securities, and investments which nothing can touch, who, thinking not of the treasure in heaven, have laid up vast treasure on earth. All ye blessed ones, intercede for us. Then we should commemorate and give thee thanks for all who, after the example of blessed and venerable Captain Wilson, despise the meek and humble of the earth, who have trodden on the faces of the oppressed, who have maintained in the dialectical society and elsewhere that great is the glory of the upper dog, all good and holy tyrants who have ground the faces of the poor to teach them the evil of poverty, all sanctified manufacturers who have won riches through the lives of helpless men and women, and girls and little children, all hallowed, glorious, and perfect Americans who, despising kings, have made a hell of their own, all excellent and worthy representative bodies, who in the wonderful name of democracy have made a very pretty penny out of the people, all humble and holy theorists, who out of love of humanity have massacred their thousands and have realized considerable sums by the process. These we commemorate, for these do we give thanks. Certainly, for money is life. It is a glorious canon, is it not? The rite of Bernard Shaw, the Shavian liturgy. It is new, it is of the 20th century. It is made for the salons of hopeless old female idiots who must be putting a finger into that which they do not understand, who, lacking the manners of a Hottentot, must be posing as successors of the great ladies of the old regime. It is new, certainly, for it is very different from the cry of the saints under the altar, who know not how long oppression and violence and wrong shall be suffered to continue, from the praise of a great failure that has always instinctively issued from all worthy human hearts from the beginning of the world. The lamb that was slain. We have outgrown all that. Let us sing the successful financier who has brought it off, and liveth in Park Lane, who has decided that poverty is the one thing he will not tolerate. Again, let us say that it is very good. We know that poverty is the greatest of crimes, and the greatest of evils, that all punishment is ferocious savagery, that bomb-throwing is as innocent as daisies and lambs in spring, that wealth is wisdom, that George Bernard Shaw does not believe in gibbets, differing from St. Paul in that respect. What is the end? Why, in the blessed future, anybody who does not see eye to eye with that Onshong must be sent to lethal chamber like a mad dog. This is the final reward of the nonconformists in the new Shaw-Rusalem. It would be far more sensible to put up with their vices as we put up with their illnesses until they give more trouble than they are worth, at which point we should, with many apologies and expressions of sympathy, and some generosity in complying with their last wishes, place them in the lethal chamber and get rid of them. Under no circumstances should they be allowed to expiate their misdeeds by a manufactured penalty, to subscribe to a charity, or to compensate the victims. Not content with the old scapegoat and sacrificial lamb, we deify human saviors and pray to miraculous virgin intercessors. Oh, wonderful condescension! Oh, admirable compassions! No longer do we send the cruel rascal to his cell, we suffocate him in the lethal chamber, with many apologies and expressions of sympathy. Must we not all pray that the kingdom of Bernard Shaw may come? How sweet to be poisoned with many apologies and expressions of sympathy in place of the cruel savagery of 40 shillings a month. Frankly, I am tired of all this. Mr. Shaw is, I am sure, a very clever man. His dramatic entertainments seem, on the whole, the only reason for regarding the English stage with the slightest atom of respect. And quite seriously, I think that if he had given his mind to the work, he might have assumed a high place in the company of the great English comic dramatists, with Sheridan and Oscar Wilde. Those who are honest know the go and come of the English theatre. They know how in certain remote days a wild orgy of rubbishy plays and of rubbishy criticism rioted on the English stage and in the English newspapers. There were depths and depths. The frantic idiotic was praised by Mr. Clement Scott, and then again Mr. William Archer announced that a new heaven and a new earth had arrived with the coming of Ibsen, not only as a playwright, but as a prophet of all things. One would have reverenced Mr. William Archer if he had not turned out to be the most accomplished apologist of the clever fraud, of the box office substitute that has ever existed. Now, let it be said that Mr. Shaw's plays are, at all events, intelligent and interesting. They are not a succession of clever tricks, but the genuine pronouncements of a genuine thinker, who has chosen the dramatic form, without much respect be it said to the conventions of the theatre. It is excellent, and one lifts one's hat to Mr. George Bernard Shaw for his honest endeavor to show that the English stage is not of necessity the cynosure of nursery maids and of saloon bar Solomons. I remember a far-off night. The late Sir Henry Irving had produced at the Lyceum the shameful, putrid, and abominable travesty of a noble spiritual legend called the Mort d'Arthur. I was sitting groaning and smoking a pipe to the scandal of the habitués, when there entered two typical first-nighters, the shiny, bediamonded, beshirted ruffians who infest the London stalls at a production. "Wonderful," said number one. "Admirable," said number two. "We come here expecting perfection, and we get it," said number one. And they swallowed their bad whiskey at 1 6 a glass, which was not so venomous as the poison that was being discussed on the stage. We may be thankful that to some extent these bad old days are over, that it is no longer possible to travesty the noblest masterpieces amidst flatulent and universal approval. And I think that Mr. Shaw is one, and perhaps the strongest of the influences that have brought about this good result. But the fact of having written a play that is not a decoction of rice pudding and whiskey and soda is not in itself a degree in philosophy. One may even fill the court theatre and not be in a position to rise superior to all the thought of all the ages, though I am sure that to fill any theatre is a very stimulating and exciting feat. I am not forgetting Mr. Shaw's other achievements. He said some very smart things about the Holy Trinity and the Savoy. I know what courage this sort of thing needs, and personally I think that there ought to be an order in recognition of these daring sallies. Still, there may be some things hidden from an Irish Protestant. The fact is that Mr. Shaw is simply an ordinary case of a man brought up in that horrible travesty of religion called Protestantism. Only in this especial case the man happens to have brains and a heart. In the usual run of circumstances, these items are missing, and one goes into business and subscribes to the Society for the Conversion of the Jews, and builds a factory, and lays waste a pleasant country, and enters Parliament, and very likely professes an enormous enthusiasm for the people that one has enslaved. The recognized method of showing that one's the people's friend is to say some hard things of the bishops. Mr. Shaw has penetrated beyond this. He sees that a successful manufacturer is by many degrees more poisonous than a burglar. He sees that the great majority of people are poor and wretched, and he concludes that they are wretched because they are poor. Here, I think, is the deadly error. It is really quite obvious, it is past denial. The poor are not inevitably wretched. The wealthy are by no means happy because of their wealth. Not a pound a day, not 1,000 pounds a day, can make any man a whit happier. For that, there needs some inward miracle, some process of the spirit that is beyond all social systems, that knows nothing of aristocracy or democracy, that laughs at poor and rich alike. I come back to my original illustration. The wounds of the spirit cannot ever be healed by the exhibition of a consommé, however artfully prepared. And when one has said this, one has answered the whole question of the distribution of wealth. It is quite true that the meek shall inherit the earth, but that does not precisely mean that those who exercise the lodger franchise shall be as happy as those who dwell in Park Lane. They may be much happier, or not nearly so happy. One is afraid that the whole socialist movement is vitiated by this monstrous fallacy, that the people with big incomes are well off, and therefore happy. Therefore everybody should have big incomes. Mr. Shaw, of course, who knew a Captain Wilson, with a very poor opinion of the Sermon on the Mount, is quite certain that everything would be all right if only everybody could live in Park Lane, because then, of course, there could be no burglars. But he has really lived long enough on the earth to know that the true riches are not in having and gaining, but in refusing and renouncing. One is sorry for a man of intelligence who is not aware of the fact that a beggar dying in the gutter may be infinitely happier than a millionaire of advanced views living in a sham Gothic palace in a country without an established church. End of section 23. Mandatum Novissimum. Section 24 of The Shining Pyramid, the Definitive Edition, by Arthur Machen. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Read by Ben Tucker. Sad, happy race. I must say at once that, in treating of the actor and of certain matters pertaining thereto, I have no intention of falling into the pit that Mr. Upton Sinclair digged for himself. This ingenious American, it will be remembered, desiring to call attention to the wretched and horrible condition of the people who work in Packingtown, Chicago, Illinois, USA, wrote a book called The Jungle, per accidens, and in addition to his denunciation of the shocking conditions under which labor putrefied and died in the service of the tinned meat magnates, he described the nauseous and disgusting manner in which nauseous and disgusting food was prepared for the market. And the result was exactly that which might have been expected. We, his readers, were prepared to hear all about the misfortunes and miseries of the poor Slav, and the unhappy Swede, and the downtrodden laborer, generally with perfect equanimity. In our own happy land there are workpeople who are perhaps not quite so comfortable as they would like to be, who are forced to live in poisonous slum settlements, and to pursue trades which mean degradation and early death. And so we were ready to suppose that something of the same kind might happen in America. Still, one can always fall back on providence and smiles and the blessings of civilization. And if the worst come to the worst, it is usually safe to say that the author must be guilty of gross exaggeration. It is quite strange how we all hate to be told the plain hard truth about anything. I remember the late Dr. Trail, an amiable man, and in many ways an excellent critic, being intensely irritated by a book called Tales of Mean Streets. This book merely said quite gently, using gray when scarlet would have been permissible, that the great majority of the London poor live under horrible and barbarous and soul-destroying conditions. I think Dr. Trail must have known in his heart that this was true, but he hated to be told this truth. But Mr. Sinclair made, as I say, the great blunder. Any little notice that his book might have brought to the poor folk of Packingtown was nullified once and for all by the larger matter of our own stomachs. Any horror that we might have had to bestow on the fate of the characters was swallowed up in the more important question. Have we eaten tinned rat and other things for luncheon? And there was an end of Mr. Sinclair's fair design. I am not going to share his fate if I can help it. I am perfectly well aware that my readers do not care two straws whether actors are humbugged, swindled, done down, bullied by vague threats into silence and submission, and to the general public it is of course a matter of complete indifference whether certain theaters offer the player the handsome choice between death by typhoid, pneumonia, or electrocution. Between 4 and 5 years ago at the Borough Theater, Stratford, I had the pleasure of seeing an actor surrounded by blue flames, and our electrician assured him that he had had a narrow escape. These trifles are nothing in themselves to the public, and if I dwell upon them and on others like them, it is because I wish to point a moral. The moral is that the miseries of the artist are likely to be reflected directly or indirectly in his art. And I hope the deduction is clear. If acting is, in the main, an uncomfortable, precarious, underpaid, ill-treated, sweated business, then the best people will be kept out of it, and consequently the performances will suffer, and therefore the public will miss several laughs and agonies that more competent players could have given them. Moreover, and this touches Londoners nearly, if from one reason or another the provincial theatres do not afford a good school, then London acting will deteriorate, and cultured, wealthy, and intelligent audiences will be brought within measurable distance of boredom. I am sure everybody will agree with me that this would be a dreadful catastrophe, and I want to make people see that it must be averted at any cost, even if actors have to be conceded some of the privileges and immunities of bricklayers and chimney sweeps. If you engage a sweep to exercise his art on 3 chimneys for 18 pence, and then put it to him that he might be a good chap and do the kitchen chimney as well to oblige, and for nothing, the man would jeer and depart. You do not say that you will send round a circular to every householder in the parish, pointing out that he is a troublesome sweep to have in the house. And if you did, he would still jeer. In analogous circumstances, the actor would tremble and obey. I see that my subject is being developed by the way of digression, but I do not know that this is of much consequence. However, an effort to keep on the straight line of thought shall be made. And to begin at the very beginning, one wonders whether acting is an art at all, even in its highest manifestation. In the work, for example, of Keane the First. For my part, I cannot think that even the impersonations of such a man as Keane could have deserved the title of art in its true sense, unless he who reads the poem beautifully is as great an artist as the poet who wrote it. This surely were an intolerable conclusion. The maker must stand on a more exalted plane than the interpreter, and Bach must be forever higher, even immeasurably higher, than the most skilled player of his fugues. And so the play and the playwright, if one be real art and the other a true artist, must always be far above the players. Indeed, there is a sense, Lamb has pointed this out in speaking of King Lear, in which the great play meditated on is a far finer thing than the play seen, as natura naturans is greater than natura naturata. The play acted has gained in distinctness, but it has parted with a whole heaven of suggestion and of mystery. It seems, then, that acting, even of the best, is not in the highest of all senses an art, for the reasons given, and for other reasons too, I think. Many people, in denying the title of art to the player's business, have alleged its fleeting, impermanent, fluid nature, and the curtain falls, and only memories remain. I was urging this argument once to an actor, and he graveled me by asking what title I should give to a painter, whose work was splendid, but faded out of sight in a few seconds. I should have answered that an analogy to a thing non-existent and inconceivable did not apply, and further that even admitting the possibility of such a transient art of painting, the analogy was bad. The actor never shows us a complete picture. He does a series of lightning sketches, each disappearing to give place to another. There is no total and simultaneous impression. The circle is barely suggested by a succession of segments. It is never totus and terris. Acting, then, may be considered as an artistic craft, and it so far partakes of the artistic matter that, in its highest grades, the faculty for it must be innate. No lessons, no experience, will make a great actor out of a man who lacks the inborn gift. Conversely, the great actors will rise from the darkest and foulest pits of evil circumstance. They will surge up out of 10th-rate melodrama companies and out of a dramatic academy. Of these we do not presume to treat in this place. Our business is rather with the clever and competent craftsman, the man who is always to be relied on for a good show, for an intelligent and lively demonstration of the character that he represents. This is the sort of actor whom circumstances can produce or exterminate. At present, circumstances seem to be exterminating him, and I have pointed out that his absence will affect the theater-going public. Not very long ago there was a Shakespearean production at a well-known theater, and more than one critic remarked that, with very few exceptions, the whole company seemed ill at ease in Shakespeare, and more especially in the speaking of blank verse. In an orchestra, I am told that it is most desirable for all the instruments, without exception, to be played in time and tune. However good the leader may be, the whole effect is said to be deplorable if the other violins are uncertain, the flutes flat, the trombones sharp, and the bassoon players just beginning to learn their business. Perhaps something remotely analogous to this state of things may sometimes be found on the boards of very creditable theaters. And here, by the way, is one of the great causes of the ordinary competent actor's decline. If it is believed that people go to see one man or one woman, or perhaps a man and a woman together, and that it doesn't matter how the other parts are played, then evidently it will not be worthwhile paying good wages to good actors, and by consequence good actors will starve and die out. The logical end of this system would be for one or two players to give the whole play between them to the accompaniment of splendid revolving scenery. At intervals, richly clad supers at 2 shillings a night would rush on and do something brisk and exciting while the stars rested their voices. If the public wish for such a state of things, there is nothing more to be said. But if they want to see a play played as a whole, then competent players must be engaged down to the smallest parts. The small part actor is a negative but necessary person. He cannot, save in rare circumstances, do any good either to the play or to himself, and in 9 cases out of 10 the audience is not consciously aware of his existence. Yet he is a part of the picture, and though he may do no good by his competence, he can do an infinite deal of harm by his incompetence. He can be the one false note in the harmony, ruining the whole effect. Well, if this average actor man that we are discussing is to be kept in existence, his life must be made tolerable. And, under our present commercial dispensation, he must be paid decent wages. I am afraid that no efforts, but merely time and circumstance, can do anything to mend one of the greatest evils in the matter of the stage. So long as hundreds of provincial towns prefer absurd blood and thunder dramas to decent plays, ancient and modern, so long will thousands of actors be trained in a very bad school, in a rubbishy method of enacting rubbish. There is no help, I say, for this. So long as melodrama pays, so long will it be produced. So long will the players be taught to practice a series of absurd conventions found to be effectual in getting rounds. Only at rare intervals can a competent recruit be gained from such a field as this. Only a strong man can go through a course of undiluted blood and remain unaffected by it. But other woes are not beyond remedy, if only the players will look to it. Take, for example, the ordinary touring contract. You have an interview with the manager, and he tells you that the tour will be 1 of 12 weeks. On this consideration, amongst others, you name the salary you require, and later a list of the towns to be visited is given you with your contract. There is, then, a convention on both sides that you are to be in receipt of, so much a week for 3 months, and you pretend to believe that this is so. But you know very well that it is not so. Your contract will be found to be terminable at a fortnight's notice on either side. You are not engaged for 3 months at all, but for a fortnight, with a fortnightly option of renewal and a fortnightly liability to dismissal. Fair to both parties? It is nothing of the kind. I know of 2 cases in which actors, for one reason or another, gave the notice in question. In the first case, the actor was told to go and never to dream of applying to that management for another engagement. In the second, the manager told the player, a beginner, that if he persisted, he would be posted in managerial circles and his career ruined. But what happens when the case is reversed? When the manager gives notice to the actor? Well, the latter goes home and starves, or gets another engagement, as the case may be. In fairness, he ought to be able to say to his manager, "If you persist, I shall denounce you to the actors' union, and no decent actor will work for you." The manager would be vastly amused. There is an actors' union, with a membership of 800 or thereabouts. Actors tell me that they are artists, and as such they do not care to be classed with low, common working men. So they stay outside their union. When the low fellows in question work overtime, they get extra pay, and I think on an advanced scale. The proud artist does his overtime, or matinee, usually for nothing, rarely for half pay. It is not at all uncommon for a whole company who have been engaged for a nominal 3 months, who have rehearsed gratis for a fortnight, to see the notice go up at the end of 6 weeks, which means that the management has robbed them of a month's pay. It is not at all uncommon for the stroller to be confronted with an announcement that the date of November 1st through 7th has not yet been filled in, which signifies the docking of a week's wages, in spite of the fact that the tour list contained the line November 1st, T.R. Mudflat. This practice, I believe, is illegal, and the salary in question would be recoverable at law. But of what use is the law to the actor? He may win his case and secure his pound or two, and be regarded ever after as a troublesome man to have in a theater. It is not to be wondered at that he grumbles in his dressing room and does nothing. Still, of course, he has the comfort of knowing that he is an artist, not a working man, so he stays outside the union. And all this, as I have said, does not tend to attract the average capable man into the profession. And by remote consequence, when Shakespeare is produced at a big London theater, the performance is a duologue, sometimes even a monologue. And there is another cause that leads to this melancholy end. That is the practice of putting raw beginners and moneyed boobies into small parts. And sometimes one is afraid, into quite considerable parts. Naturally, the result is ruinous. The booby spoils his part, and does his best to spoil the whole play. and all the while he is keeping a man of experience out of a living. In Utopia, managers will agree together that this practice shall cease. In London it will continue, and performances will get more ragged and incompetent, and the good craftsman will become scarcer, till the general public signifies in some way or another that it is displeased with the result. There are many reasons why the music halls flourish at the theater's expense, and perhaps one of them is that the music hall artistes, with few exceptions, know their business. An evening at a good hall does not mean Mr. Blank and Miss Dash supported by a large company of idiots and incompetents. I have heard of a manager who was very proud of a wall which was made of real bricks. It would be better to boast of a company composed of real actors. Players, in spite of their miseries and misfortunes, are in the main good-tempered folk. They grumble and bear it, if they cannot always grin and bear it. So it is only fitting that the recital of a few of their woes should end on a more cheerful note. I have been waiting for the last few weeks for a certain article in the daily or weekly press, and that article is the fit eulogy of Mr. F.R. Benson's company from the pen of some competent Bensonian veteran. The article has not appeared, or at any rate I have not seen it, and so I make bold here to consecrate a little space to the man who has done more for the craft of acting than all other managers put together. The other managers, one does not blame them, are not in the business for their health. They are more or less obedient to the maxim endorsed by that great literary authority, Mr. Arnold Bennett. Money talks. And many of them have well deserved the success that they have attained in the commercial order. But for the last 25 years, Mr. Benson has both preached and practiced the better gospel of the craft for the craft's sake. At one point and another he has produced almost all the plays of Shakespeare, and with but splendor means he has surpassed the West End managers in accuracy and historical knowledge, if not in material splendors and in real velvet at 25 shillings a yard. I once heard a dialogue between the antiquarian advisor of a fashionable theater and an old Bensonian, the latter being not only an actor, but a sound authority on heraldry and costume. The antiquary was scoffing at the idea of Mr. Benson producing a certain piece which this person had decorated and costumed in town. "How can Benson dress such a play?" said the antiquary. "He will dress it in the costume of the period," answered the old Bensonian, "not in dresses 50 years after date like yours." But Mr. Benson has excelled in more important paths than these. He has just celebrated the 25th birthday of his company, and he may reflect with pleasure on the fact that during all this time he has kept the best possible school of acting that England has possessed, or is likely to possess. I have heard that somewhere in London there is an academy of acting, a place with professors and lecturers and such apparatus, a place where well-to-do beginners can be coached in a special part, taught to parrot Hamlet, let us say, for 30 shillings a week, a procedure which saves the touring manager money and is, of course, greatly to the benefit of the whole profession. Mr. Benson has not such high pretensions. He does not profess to turn out dramatic geniuses to order, and when I had the honor of entering his company, he had neither lectures nor professors. But the man who started his career with Mr. Benson in the old days learned the craft in the only possible way. He began at the bottom. He walked on for about a year. He was entrusted with a line or two. He was given a small part. He was given a larger part, as his ability and readiness deserved. A clever young fellow at special seasons, such as the Stratford celebration, might be called on to play, say, 12 minor and varying parts in the course of a week. It is scarcely necessary to compare such a school as this with the work of academies. With the 3 or 4 parts in the year that the young actor has the chance of playing in the ordinary run of the profession. And not only is such a diverse experience of the utmost of incalculable value in the formation of a sound, well-trained actor, but the method employed, and I have no doubt it is, the whole heavens above the ordinary stage management to which the beginner is usually subjected. Under the system to which I have alluded, the system of Mr. Blank and Miss Dash, supported by a large company of idiots and incompetents, it is a question of drilling inexperienced people into automats. Their speech is measured, their gestures are measured, their stations on the stage are chalked out for them. Indeed, this is the only way when 30 shillings is doing the work of 5 pounds. But Mr. Benson, who has the passion of Shakespeare, expects his company to cherish something of the same ardor in their breasts, to think for themselves, to watch the work of their elders, to bring something of the freedom of nature and of life onto the boards, to be men and women, not things that have been wound up by the puppet showman, that can always be depended upon to be a certain square at a certain moment, and to waggle the little finger of the left hand according to the careful instructions at a given cue. There is no company where the necessary technique is so thoroughly taught, but it is a technique of general principles and of general application, and no matter of a certain gesture or a certain tone prescribed without reason given for a certain line and repeated mechanically without feeling and without intelligence. Before I knew anything about the stage, I met an actor who spoke with authority. He had played, I think, one part for 5 years in Charlie's Aunt. "The Bensonians," he said, "are capital fellows and good athletes, but they can't act." I believe that it is only necessary to think of certain names now honored on our London boards to decide that this gentleman was an ass. For my part, I wish to take leave of Mr. F.R. Benson and of his company in the words of the ingenious gentleman Don Quixote of La Mancha. "Godspeed, you good people. Keep your festival, and remember, if you demand of me aught wherein I can render you a service, I will do it gladly and willingly, for from a child I was fond of the play, and in my youth a keen lover of the actor's art." End of section 24. Sad Happy Race. Section 25 of The Shining Pyramid, the definitive edition by Arthur Machen. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain, read by Ben Tucker. The Capital Levy, an essay in economics. A little politics, I think, for a change. We have all enjoyed the Christmas feast tremendously. I trust we have done our duty as Britons to the turkey, the plum pudding, the mince pies, the port, and the punch, both as a pleasure and as a sacred duty. See the old parson's Christmas sermon in Washington Irving's dear book. Very good. But the fare is rich and full-bodied. It may not be amiss to take something tart and dry and astringent by way of an alternative, as I think the doctors call such a medicine. I call it a pick-me-up. Well, it has gradually filtered into my intelligence, which knows little and cares less about politics, that there has been a general election, and that the Labour Party is the second largest party in the House, polling, by the way, a huge number of votes, which under other electoral systems would have secured them many more seats than they actually hold. And what these formidable fellows want is a capital levy, and, put it plain and put it short, that means taking away money from the haves and giving it to the have-nots. Now, it is not my business to determine whether this would be a good plan or not. Frankly speaking, most emphatically as one of the have-nots, rather, as one of the vagabonds who hope each night that the farmer's fowls are not too noisy, and that the thicket in the wild field is not too wet to sleep in, frankly, from this my point of view, I should think that the capital levy is nonsense. I don't believe that I should get a penny of it. I think it would go in building more palaces like Australia House and the Strand, and in paying large numbers of official patriots very handsomely. I believe that all the wise folks, not being fanatics, have always declared that dividing up was rubbish. It is said that the condition of the common average man in Russia is not noticeably better now than it was in the days of the Little Father, though that was by no means a golden age. Then the Swiss, a solid people who have run the commonwealth of the common man with very considerable success for some hundreds of years, they will have nothing to say to this Morrison's pill remedy, to quote Carlyle, of a capital levy. The early Christians tried the plan for a few years, but they soon abandoned it, and considering their zeal and their admirable fervor, it would almost seem that the plan is radically incompatible with human nature. It is of no good for man to pretend he has three legs unless he is a sideshow in a circus. The impersonation is sure to break down, and to break down in a somewhat lamentable manner. Still, this is all beside the mark. The point is that the very large number of votes cast for the Labour Party and the capital levy signifies that there is a vast body of discontent in the country, a vast number of people who feel that things are all wrong and that these vague things should be and can be made right. I entirely agree with them, but I don't think that what they really want is more money, though that would be very nice too, if it could be managed. I believe that they are discontented, and rightly discontented, because the work that most of them do is entirely unfit for humanity, because in consequence they are bored to tears, angry, sullen, in an ill humor. It sounds somewhat shocking, but if anything like modern industrialism could have existed in ancient times, The only workers would have been slaves and criminals. In the old service books, there were prayers for those in the mines. I don't wonder at it. How would you and I like to pass a great part of our lives in a deep, black, hot hole in the ground, lying on our backs in a low, narrow passage, hacking away the coal over our heads? And then the other people, the people who are above ground. I remember once when I was strolling about England, being roused early in the morning at a place called Farnsworth, not very far from Manchester. I may mention, by the way, that the only thing that would do Farnsworth any good would be TNT and plenty of it. Well, I was roused at this horrid Farnsworth between 5 and 6 in the morning by a clattering on the pavement outside. It was a grey morning, and a grey cold drizzle of rain was falling, and below in the mean ugly street the mill girls with grey shawls on their heads were clattering along in their clogs to the mills, there to be a part of mechanism all day long. To have a little more sense than the looms they tended, but not much. Is it to be wondered that such a life breeds sour discontent? It would be awful indeed if it did not breed discontent, for then humanity would have fled from the human heart. There is another instance that occurs to me. I remember 12 years ago there was an exhibition of the boot industry up at Islington. The exhibition had a pretty poster called Then and Now, or some such title. One side of it showed a pleasant old man sitting at the door of his pleasant old cottage, affectionately tapping away at a boot, which, be it understood, he had made all by himself. Every slice of leather was his doing, every stitch his sewing, every nail his hammering. When the boots were finished, they would be his humble masterpiece. He might have signed their souls, if he would. Adonijah Marbuck Fessit. Then on the other side of the poster was a brisk young fellow of today, in a modern boot factory, handling some sort of a lever and some sort of a mechanism, and presumably performing the 10th or 20th or 30th process involved in bootmaking as it now is, and destined to do nothing else for the rest of his life. In the poster, this young man looks happy and contented. But he isn't. He votes for the Labour Party, and for loot. I am not in the least surprised. Would you like to depress that lever, move it slightly to the right, raise it, depress it to the left, all day and every day for the natural term of your life? I hope not. And the worst of it is, there is no remedy, no possibility of a remedy. Let us have a benevolent despot who would abolish all machinery invented after the 17th century. The result would be that in a few months, a very few months, we should all be starving in tattered clothes and bare feet, and rather worse off than the Russians are today. It is not to be done. It will be noted that I have said nothing about the dangerous trades. I don't think they matter much. Men are not much affected by danger and risk and hazard, nor even by horrible physical discomfort. In fact, many men incur all these things voluntarily and joyfully, and call it sport and adventure and exploration and the army and so forth. If the manufacture of China were a dread adventure, with the risk of poison always and certainly present, but always a tremendous uncertainty as to what might happen any day, any hour, then we should have expeditions to Henley and Stoke, and heroes insisting on lead-glazing vegetable dishes and sauce-boats with memorial services at St. Paul's for the mighty dead. But it is not so, and it cannot be so. We are bound on the industrial wheel, and that wheel must revolve remorselessly till the end of our era. So far as we can see, boots are going to be made by mechanical processes, and not by individual craft and thought and labor up to the very end of anything that we can conceive. I repeat, the money question, the question of what recompense the laboring man is to receive for leading a dreary, mechanical, and inhuman life, is important enough. But it is not the question. If money were the root of this sad evil, then the working man would not find his chief delight in finding winners, which are mostly losers and cost him dear. For I believe there is very little doubt amongst those who know that backing horses is distinctly unprofitable for the backers. Peers have come to horrid grief over it, and so have plasters. There are streaks and flashes of luck, of course, but from the practical point of view, it is the baddest of all bad business. The bookies grow to be shining men with red, prosperous necks. The backers go groaning as far as money is concerned, but they go on backing. I see them in bar corners, the evening paper opened at the sporting page, standing with knotted brows, poring over the elaborate tables of tips, comparing the prophecy of the marshal with the prophecy of Sticker Axe weighing the judgment of peppermint with the judgment of the lad, calculating, pondering, speculating, and enjoying themselves enormously. Sometimes there enters suddenly one with high importance in his air. He beckons to his friend, he whispers in his ear secrets, sure secrets that come by devious ways from the very stable itself. There is deep conference, again intense enjoyment, and in the long run a balance on the wrong side so far as the backer is concerned. He doesn't care, something went wrong with the Berkshire, but he has a dead cert for the Leicester. Clearly, then, the root of the problem is not to be sought for in the matter of money, for if it were, working men would not pass so much time in doing their best to lose what they have. So far as money is concerned, I have always held that co-partnership is the only solution. Not only, nor chiefly, because labor would have a larger share of the profits, and very justly, too, but because an element of uncertainty would be introduced into labor's existence, and uncertainty is one of the great salts of life. If it be not the essential salt of all human life. The weekly wage would go on as before, but what about that three-monthly or six-monthly bonus? Why, I believe that every factory would get up a sweepstake as to the amount and so add sweetness to sweetness. Meanwhile, gambling in all its forms should be encouraged, if life is not to become intolerable for the wage slaves. I am delighted to see that ingenious persons have succeeded of late in driving a tunnel right under the lottery axe. For a mere half-crown, you can have a chance of winning £2,000. There is something to think about as you raise the lever and move it to the right, depress it and move it to the left, in deadly repetition all day long. The unpalatable dry meat of daily existence is salted, seasoned, made endurable by the element of wonder, surmise, uncertainty that has been mingled with it. Assuredly, the inventors of ballots are public benefactors. Of course, there are other ways of palliating the boredom of modern existence. There is the interesting case of the sporting nobleman, confronted every winter with the cessation of racing on the flat. What was he to do with himself? He consulted a wise man who told him to go and be an Egyptologist. He followed this advice, and a month or two ago the quest of years was rewarded. His picks and spades burst into the treasure house of the dead kings with the strange names who reigned in Egypt nearly 4,000 years ago. And he saw the wonderful things of gold and lapis lazuli that had been laid there in secret hundreds of years before Troy fell, nearly 1,000 years before Romulus raised the walls of Rome. That was a great moment indeed. But Egyptian exploration is a sport beyond the means of most of us, and out of the question where factory hands and miners are concerned. No, Egyptology is no solution for the labor unrest, and writing books, another way, is more a vice than a sport. Let the Labor Party bring in a co-partnership bill instead of that capital levy nonsense, while their followers spot winners and buy tickets and all the ballots going. Thus we shall get along tolerably, if not very well. End of section 25, The Capital Levy. Chapter 26 of The Shining Pyramid, The Definitive Edition, by Arthur Machen. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Read by Ben Tucker. Drake's Drum. Take my drum to England. Hang it by the shore. Strike it when your powder's running low. If the dawn's sight Devon, I'll quit the port of heaven and drum them up the channel as we drummed them long ago. Sir Henry Newbolt. We wake sometimes from dreams uttering strange phrases, murmuring incredible things. At the moment of waking for some ineffable instant of time, the words we speak, or perhaps think we speak, seem to us full of illumination. To everyone who speculates at all as to the heights and depths of the soul, there comes at very rare moments, there are not perhaps more than half a dozen such experiences given to any man's lifetime, the sense of the true world, which lies beyond this dark place of images and shadows. A world that is full of light and glory. A world where all our dim desires are interpreted and fulfilled. It is as if we stood among shadows before a black curtain, as if for one moment a fold were caught back and we saw that which we can never utter, but never deny. In dreams and waking, and in waking dreams, most of us, I suppose, penetrate into this other world, the world beyond the black curtain. But we are not suffered to make any report of it. The secret, it seems, must be kept fast, And that is one of the reasons why I am usually inclined to disbelieve most stories of the communicating spirits of the dead. Their messages are, to my judgment, altogether too lucid, too comfortably and easily and clearly set forth. There is no obscurity in the interpretation of their sentences, no impression as of a great gulf of the spirit which has been traversed with the utmost difficulty. And if we, still in the flesh, cannot utter to ourselves our own visions, it scarcely seems like that those who have passed beyond the flaming ramparts of the world should be able to chatter to us so easily and colloquially of the regions of their dwelling. The speech of that far land, if any speech there be, will, I think, be delivered rather in sensible images than in logical and grammatical utterance. And it is only the unspiritual who can discern nothing of the spirit in things audibly or visibly presented to our senses. Here is the true story of such a presentation. On the 11th of last November, the armistice between the Allies and the German Empire was signed. This meant that the incredible had happened. A few months before, all the world had been in terror of a power that seemed capable of fighting all the world. Now, in a moment, as if by enchantment, that power had ceased to exist. The armistice terms were, most justly and wisely, rigorous. And on November 21st, it was appointed that practically the whole German fleet should surrender to the British. I said that the whole event was incredible, and so true is this that the British Navy could scarcely believe that the surrender would be accomplished peacefully. Sailors are generous men to all, but more especially to other sailors. There is a brotherhood of the deep which surpasses the bounds of nations, and our Navy could not believe that the German sailors would give up their ships without fighting, even though the fight might be a hopeless one for them. Consequently, on the morning of November 21st, 1918, the British Navy awaited the enemy in a state of mind that is hard to describe. The surrender of the German fleet, they all knew, had been demanded and granted, but at the last moment, our men thought, the unutterable disgrace must boil in the veins of those German sailors, and the guns of their great ships must speak their final word of fire before they sank beneath the water. Every preparation was made for the fight. The ships were cleared. The men were at action stations. Naval discipline was at its strictest. Every man on board every ship knew his place to an inch, his duty to the most minute detail. The king's ships had made them ready for battle. It is hard for a landsman to realize this awful and inexorable import of such an array. The fleet steamed to the appointed rendezvous, waited, and looked eastward. It was a misty morning with a gentle breeze. One of the ships was the Royal Oak, chiefly manned by sailors of Devonshire. She was flying on that day a magnificent silk ensign, made for her by Devonshire ladies. On a bridge, 60 feet above the top deck, was a group of officers, Admiral Grant, Captain McLaughlin of the Royal Oak, the commander, and others. It was soon after 9 o'clock in the morning when the German fleet appeared looming through the mist. Admiral Grant saw them and waited. He could scarcely believe, he says, that they would not instantly open fire. Then the drum began to beat on the Royal Oak. The sound was unmistakable. It was that of a small drum being beaten in rolls. At first, the officers on the bridge paid little attention, if any, to the sound. So intent were they on the approaching enemy. But when it became evident that the Germans were not to show fight, Admiral Grant turned to the captain of the Royal Oak and remarked on the beating of the drum. The captain said that he heard it but could not understand it, since the ship was cleared for action and every man on board was at his battle station. The commander also heard but could not understand and sent messengers all over the ship to investigate. Twice the messengers were sent about the ship, about all the decks. They reported that every man was at his station. Yet the drum continued to beat. Then the commander himself made a special tour of investigation through the Royal Oak. He too found that every man was at his station. It must be noted, by the way, that if someone playing a practical joke had been beating a drum between decks, the sound would have been inaudible to the officers on the bridge. Secondly, when a ship is cleared for action, the members of the band have specially important duties in connection with fire control apparatus assigned to them. The band instruments are all stored away in the band room, right aft and below decks. All the while, the British fleet was closing round the German fleet, coming to anchor in a square about it so that the German ships were hemmed in. And all the while that this was being done, the noise of the drum was heard at intervals, beating in rolls. All who heard it are convinced that it was no sound of flapping stays or any such accident. The ear of the naval officer is attuned to all the noises of his ship, in fair weather and in foul. It makes no mistakes. All who heard knew that they heard the rolling of a drum. At about 2 o'clock in the afternoon, the German fleet was enclosed and helpless, and the British ships dropped anchor, some 15 miles off the Firth of Forth. The utter irrevocable ruin and disgrace of the German navy were consummated, and at that moment the drum stopped beating and was no more heard. But those who had heard it, admiral, captain, commander, other officers and men of all ratings, held then and hold now one belief as to that rolling music. They believed that the sound they heard was that of Drake's drum, the audible manifestation of the spirit of the great sea captain, present at this hour of the tremendous triumph of Britain on seas. This is the firm belief of them all. It may be so. It may be that Drake did quit the port of heaven in a ship of fire, and driving the Huns across the sea with the flame of his spirit, drummed them down to their pitiful and shameful doom. End of section 26, Drake's Drum. End of The Shining Pyramid, the definitive edition, by Arthur Machen.